Once our data are sorted, we can process them further very efficiently. We can find unique and duplicate records. We can count the number of same records. We can perform set difference and intersection operations. And we can even perform relational joins. The unique command allows us to select and count consecutive identical lines.
Although I have used unique numerous times up to now, let's see a more complete example. We'll use the log file var log access log, which is a log file in the form written by popular web servers. As you can see, each line contains the IP address of the host connected to the web server, the date, the corresponding HTTP command, the URL, the result, as well as further details about the connected client. Our task here is to list all top-level domains included in this file, such as .com or .edu, by the number of their connections. The first step is to convert the IP address into actual domain names. There's a command named logresolve that can do that. This reads the log file and replaces the initial IP address with its resolved domain name. I run logresolved on the log file and store the output in another file named resolved. We notice in the output that some addresses, such as the one starting with 175, were not resolved. However, others were successfully converted to their domain names. Our second step is to isolate the domain names using the cat command. I run cat on the resolved file, specifying space as the field separator and selecting the first field. Thus, we only get the domain names accessing the web server. We see various names ending in top-level domains, such as .de or .com. The next step involves obtaining the top-level domains from the domain names. These correspond to the last part of the name. To do that, after cutting, I pipe the output to the awk command. I specify dot as the field separator and print the last field, which is stored in the $nf variable. The NF variable corresponds to the number of fields. For example, if there are 5 fields, NF is equal to 5 and $NF prints the 5th field. That's how we get the top-level domains. Having now obtained them, we need to remove any numerical domains such as 115, which we saw above. I run grep-v on aux output, removing all lines containing numbers with this regular expression. Now is the time to sort the output by the top-level domain. Notice how the Argentina domain comes first, then Belgium, and so on. As a next step, I pipe the output to unique-c to count the occurrences of each top-level domain. Finally, as we have repeatedly done in previous examples, after counting the domain occurrences, I sort them in reverse numerical order. We see that .com comes first, .net comes second, then comes .de of Germany, and so on.
The com command will process already sorted files in order to list lines that only exist in the first file, in the second file, or in both of them. This is very useful because it allows us to perform diverse set operations.
As an example, consider the case of comparing the executable files available on 2 flavors of the Unix system. On my local Linux system, I list the executable files under the /bin directory. I save their names into a file named linux.bin. Next, I SSH to a FreeBSD machine. I list its /bin directory again and save its contents to another local file named freebsd.bin. As the output of ls is already sorted by name, in this way I have 2 sorted files which I can now compare and find their similarities and differences. With the com command, we can create an output file with 3 columns. The first column contains the lines occurring only in the first file, in this case linux.bin. Similarly, the second column contains the lines occurring only in the second file, here freebsd.bin. The third column contains the lines common to both files. We see in this case that Linux contains some unique executable files, such as bash and bnzip2, On the other hand, FreeBSD contains two flags and two I/O. The cat command exists in both systems. What's more, COM allows us to suppress columns through its numerical options. For instance, running COM-23 on the two files, I suppress the second column, which contains the unique files of Linux, and the third column with the two systems' common files. Thus, we only get the first column with the unique files of FreeBSD. In the same way, running COM-13, we only get the unique files of Linux. Counting them, we see that these are about 100. Finally, running COM-12 outputs the executable files that are common on both systems, such as cat, chmod, cp, and so on.
Few know that we can perform relational joins, the bread and butter of database systems, with Unix tools. This is exactly what the join command does.
To see a practical application of join, let's find all file clones in the current directory, that is, files with the exact same contents. Rather than comparing each file with each other one, which would take a very long time, we can do it very efficiently by first obtaining a short but probably unique signature of each file and working with that. The signature we will use is the outcome of running a cryptographic hash function on the file. Here, I use the message digest MD5 algorithm with the command MD5sum. For example, running MD5sum on the readme.txt file, we get a 128-bit result listed here in hexadecimal. This value uniquely represents the file's contents with a very high probability. It is much easier to process this value than the entire file. Back to our task, as a first step, I find all plain files and process them through xargs with MD5sum to get their signatures. I store these in a file named MD5sum.out. Listing the contents of this file, we see that each line contains a file's MD5 value and the file name. Our next step is to isolate the MD5 values. Similarly with the earlier domains example, I run cat on the above file, specifying space as the field separator and requesting the first field which contains the MD5 signature values. Next, I repeat the usual routine of isolating the signatures and sorting them. But this time, instead of piping the output to unique-c, I pipe it to unique-d to get all duplicate lines. D stands for duplicate. I store the duplicate lines, which contain the duplicate MD5 values, in a file named duplicates. Displaying the file's contents, we see the duplicate signatures, or in other words, the file clones we are looking for. Unfortunately, we got the file's MD5 values, but lost the actual file names in the process. To retrieve them again, we can join the file contents of the MD5 values with the initial file's values. So, we need to join the duplicates files with the MD5sum.out file. To do this, I first sort all files' MD5 values and then join them with the duplicates' MD5 values. As a result, each output line now contains the MD5 value of a file clone and the file name. We see that the output file names are probably duplicates, such as devtape.h, indent.pro, and so on.
The commands we saw in this unit work extremely well with a remarkable feature of the bash shell, the ability to specify as input file argument the output of another command.
Although this feature is only available on the bash shell and not on the traditional bourne shell, it's so useful it's worth looking at it. To specify that the command's input file argument is another command's output, we use a less than sign and the command enclosed in brackets. In this example, I want to compare two sorted files and only list the unique lines of the first one, specifying the input files to be the output of two processes. After running COM-23, less than open bracket, the first input file I specify is a list of tape archive files. To get this list, I run tar on the archive file, cutting from it columns 49 onwards which include the file names, and then sort the output. Although the input comes from a process, COM interprets it as a file. Similarly, the second input file of COM is the output of another tar process. I run tar on another archive file, again cutting the columns with the file names, and sort them. Piping the output to head, we see all unique files of the first tape archive file.
The bash shell also gives us the ability to specify as an output file argument a command that receives as input what would normally go into the corresponding file.
For instance, consider the case where we want to list the current directory's files and count their number. For this task, we can use the T command, which was named after the T splitter used in plumbing. T reads from the standard input and writes to both the standard output and one or more files. It is very useful as part of a pipeline. In our example, I first use ls and then pipe the output to T, specifying that T's output file is a process, wc-l. The bash's syntax for that is a greater than sign followed by the process we want and closed in brackets. Running this command sequence, we get a file list and their total number, 7 in this case.
This concludes our unit on processing sorted data. Stay with us.